So, I've given the rather bold title of asserting the sustainable drainage. I don't intend to assert it here, but what I do hope is going to apply through my presentation and some of the things I'll talk about, and help us all start thinking about what we can do as professionals involved in that area to try to assert the sustainable drainage agenda. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to talk about a true story about a project in the States which used sustainable drainage to achieve some really good cost-effective water quality solutions. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about sustainable drainage and its philosophy. I'll follow on from that with simplified kind of example of how we can build a sustainable development. Then at the end, we'll talk about how we assert this, how we assert this in general, try and get more widespread sustainable drainage developments, if you like. Okay, so to start off, I'm going to talk about New York City and the water supply in New York City. So it gets all of its water supply from the Catskills and Delaware catchment, which is a green area up there, and then it flows down into some reservoirs where it's held, and it's transported to the residents of New York City. Now, their challenge with all drinking water is to try and get rid of the brown stuff and get some nice clean stuff that you can drink. Although if you're from the west of Ireland, you're probably quite used to drinking some of the brown stuff as it goes through the boggy areas. So in the early 90s, they needed to do something to improve the water quality, put in new infrastructure, and they were faced really with looking at a capital investment of $6 to $8 billion, coupled with $200 to $300 million a year to operate and maintain these assets. So they came up with this innovative approach, which involved using sustainable drainage techniques. They call it filter avoidance determination, FAD for short. So what did it involve? Basically, it involved paying the landowners in the catchment to set aside a buffer strip at the edge of the stream, set it aside, leave it to nature, and then also on top of that, in the farming techniques that they were employing to use sort of, I suppose, sustainable techniques that didn't prevent the soil erosion and reduce sort of oversaturation with pollutants and pesticides and this kind of thing. So this is just an example of a photo of where that would be done, and sort of a little schematic. I think some oversized cows on the side of the stream, but it's the idea is pretty simple. You don't need a huge amount of room, 10 meters, 20 meters, maybe 50 meters, whatever it is, depending on what's going on. It's not going to take up that much room in the greater scheme of things, particularly in something like this, which is working on a macro scale. And what obviously happens then is any of the runoff coming through, the sediment is taken out by the vegetation, and so what you've got is pretty nice clear water, free of most pollutants, because a lot of pollutants generally adhere to the sediment. So if you take the sediment out, that's half the battle, or most of it. So the results were nice clean water. It wasn't quite right, frankly, but it was along those lines. All they really had to do with the water when it arrived, when they tested it, it was add a bit of fluoride and chlorine, and that met the EPA requirements, which is pretty good, and it's what you want to do. And it's also and it received ongoing approval. So this we're talking back, I think, in 1993, FAD was first approved. It's been going ever since. It got an extension up to 2017. It's being reviewed this year, but there's every likelihood that it'll continue again. And that cost, over that time period, the estimated cost of paying the landowners, everything else, every little bit of maintenance and whatever it happens, there's only a million. So a couple of slides back, I'm afraid, estimating it was going to be 6 to 8 billion just capital expenditure alone. So that's a huge saving. So looking at sustainable drainage philosophy, going to look at it more sort of a micro scale, but bearing in mind that but if you improve enough, if you implement enough things at the micro scale, it will have significant benefits on the micro scale. So sustainable drainage, what is it? The one I'm more familiar with from working in Ireland and the UK is SUDS, sustainable drainage systems. But obviously there's WSSUD in Australia, or sense of urban design. The states, I think, have got it's called best management practices. And there's this great book, the SUDS manual, which just has wonderful, wonderful examples. It's free to download, and I encourage anyone who's interested in sustainable drainage who hasn't looked at it all, have a look at it. It's published by Syria. And in essence, what SUDS sets out, and this is the same real philosophy for all sustainable drainage, it's about looking at water quality, quantity, providing some amenity, and improving or maintaining biodiversity. And so what we're talking about there, in terms of the quality, so with the Catskills example in New York, we've got the filter. We're filtering the water through, we're taking the sediment out. So it's sort of trying to incorporate a filter or a series of filters within a field of urban development or whatever sort of development it is to try and reduce the sediment load for the water that's flowing out. In terms of quantity, we're talking about either slowing the runoff, the rainfall runoff rate down, or providing storage, or in a lot of cases, a bit of both. So while you soften something up with something green or something gravel or whatever, you you slow down the runoff rate, but you're also providing little bits of storage within the sort of the voids of the gravel or within the vegetation itself. The other idea there, by the way, with the mud is that you build stuff that can be permeable. Now that's not always possible. But you allow water to permeate down through the soil rather than sending it all out and into the drainage network. Amenity. So amenity can come in many shapes and sizes. The amenity of having more greenery. I've given a few presentations today and we're talking about how important it is for us as humans to be around greenery. It can also be amenity just in terms of parking areas or whatever. We'll talk a bit about that later. And then biodiversity. Biodiversity wasn't always an aspect of the SUDS philosophy. It was added more recently. And I think it's in recognition that in all the developments, yeah, and don't get me wrong, I'm all for development. I'm an engineer. We've got to, that's what we do. You know, as a society, we're always looking to develop, but it's doing it sustainably. And it's also recognizing that in making, you know, building these developments, we can quite often be taking away swathes of untouched land that's developed all sorts of ecosystems and developed a lot of biodiversity in terms of flora and fauna. So what do we do to try and preserve that, or at least encourage some of it to grow again or something like that? So SUDS also promotes this treatment train approach, and this is particularly relevant for the quality aspect. And it's really just setting a series of filters through which the rainfall has to go through. And we're also talking about runoff of from roads, which picks up hydrocarbons and other, you know, sediment loads and all that kind of stuff. And what this graphic kind of shows here, obviously, the rainfall comes down, you can intercept it with a green roof, some of it hits vehicles, turns into vehicular runoff with hydrocarbons and whatnot. Then it comes down on one side onto the road, on the other side through the building. Second from the bottom, we've got a swale catching it all, and then it goes out to the water course. You could also add in another line there between the swale and the water course. It could be some tension or attenuation basin. So the idea is that at each of these stages, yeah, we put in some sort of filtration. Now, arguably, for rainfall falling on a roof, you could say, well, it's probably pretty pure as it is, so the filtration element isn't quite as important. But then there's other things that really work for in terms of the rainfall runoff rate down, and also climate community. So if we look, speaking of green roofs, I'm a huge fan of green roofs. I think they're wonderful. And I've got this, I took this down in, we were on holidays last year in South of Ireland. And this, what I particularly liked about this green roof is a lot of people think green roofs can only go on flat buildings. Well, this roof doesn't. They can go on all sorts of buildings. So these sort of arched or vaulted roofs, there's no problem that they got the green roof in. I've also seen green roofs on slanted roofs. There is a, once it gets to a certain degree, you can't get the green roof on, but generally you can. Green roofs, as I said, okay, they're great, they provide great amenities. They're great for slowing the rainfall down, they provide storage. You can also provide biodiversity to both flora and fauna as well. There's all sorts. There's a guy who went on a course in London, run by a town, Dusty Gedge, who's a green roof enthusiast. He brought us to a place where they have a green roof, and it's quite green roof. This one's green, it's just made up of sort of old crushed bricks and glass, and it's molded so that there's little undulations. And there's a certain type of bee or wasp that lives in these little mounds. And up until then, this species had been lost in the environment. So there's huge opportunity for certainly the quantity element, the energy, biodiversity. Rain gardens. They don't necessarily have to be large and such. They can be very, you've either got your pile discharging straight onto a surface, or it could go underground and into a perforated pipe. And so then you're getting the water dispersing out and infiltrating. So it can also be, like I said, just not to be a garden. If the maintenance of the garden is an issue for some people, it could be a gravel area, grass area, it could even just be a paved area, as long as there's some means for the water to get down into the subsurface. So in terms of the quantity element with the runoff, it obviously reduces the runoff again. It provides some flood storage. From a quality point of view, it's providing another filtration, removes the sediment. From an amenity point of view, I think it speaks for itself. Biodiversity, well, again, it can be, something you can put in what you want in terms of flora, and you can also microbial and insect life there if you want. Swales and sort of filter strips side of the swale. Swales are great. I know you see an awful lot of swales side of roads like this one. Swales are really simple. Just a small depression, channel your water into it rather than going into a pipe. There are going to be areas where you might need a pipe connection, that kind of thing. But what it allows is, as particularly for runoff vehicles, which has a lot of hydrocarbons and all these other kind of pollutants. As it flows across, sheet flows across, it gets slowed down by the blades of grass or whatever other vegetation you have in there. And the sediment settles out, and the vast, it's 90-odd% of pollutants adhere to sediment, so you get the sediment out, and that's your sort of pollution mitigation. Swales can also be, again, if it's an issue with the vegetation side, and people, you know, concerned about maintenance and all that, they can't just be, you know, rock channels or gravel channels and this kind of thing. It's all about the filtration. It's all about sending water through something that's going to slow it down and take that sediment out. And then, the side of the road, you can have permanent paving. And again, it's the same philosophy, that the water flows across the paving. There's little holes or gaps between each of the pavers. It flows down through that. It goes into an underground medium, being like some sort of gravel, or, and flows again in through there and down into the groundwater. And it's all been, again, sediment's kind of been removed. So stitching all these elements together, it's a bit blurry, but this is a schematic I put together, and it's not dissimilar to some developments I have worked with others in design. Basically, you've got your green roof at the top, your rain garden, your swale along the side, you've got a permeable pavement here for the parking areas. So it's all pretty simple, I think, to stitch it together. And it's not like we're taking up a huge amount of room, a huge amount of development area from the developers or anything like that. So finally, moving on to the whole point, how do we assert sustainable drainage, I've had a few talks about this, and I'm not saying that by far I have the answers, and I'm not saying that any one of these is the answer. I think it's a combination of things. But I certainly think there's something, we have to look at this problem, you know, from a financial perspective. And the Catskills example, I think, is a great example of just showing how sustainable drainage can be far more cost effective. There's often people say, well, sustainable drainage is more expensive, this and that and the other. We've got to start looking at how we find these cost savings. So, you know, in terms of quality and quantity, well, if the water coming out of developments is cleaner than in where traditional drainage has been applied, which it should be, won't that have an impact, especially when we have applying sustainable drainage on a widespread scale, won't that have an impact on the water treatment costs? So they should go down. So maybe there's some sort of saving there that can be returned to the developer. In a similar way, the quantity will, in terms of flood maintenance and flood levels and all that kind of stuff, by incorporating lots of sustainable drainage within developments we're providing flood storage. And that's, again, that should be seen as a benefit and maybe quantified financially with some means of returning that to the developer. The amenity aspect, or maybe we look at particularly in high density urban developments, maybe we say, well, if you put green roofs everywhere, you can increase your density, because you don't, you know, your green roof, your roof space can count as part of your open space, your green space. So in that instance, maybe a developer can actually make more of it. Biodiversity is one that's kind of hard to quantify or qualify. What I would say, it's great, but what can we do? I suppose it could be used as a marketing tool for developers to say, by, you know, taking these approaches, you're buying the property where you're going to be most impacted to the environment and enhance or maintain the biodiversity. Energy, definitely think there's significant energy costs that can be made by implementing particularly green roofs. In terms of insulation during the winter and cooling during the summer. some other aspects? Well, looking at legislation, do we need stiffer legislation? Do we need to, is it just that we don't enforce the legislation as it should be? Education is definitely one that, I suppose, for a lot of engineers who work in this area, we're sort of exposed to this, and we know how it works and all that, but what are we doing to promote that, broadcast that beyond? How are we helping developers and contractors understand how they need to how to construct some of these things? Cost benefit analysis, again, I think this is something we should be looking at at an early stage with planners, architects, developers, everyone. Having a good look at the catchment plan, identifying if sustainable drainage was implemented across a big catchment, what the impact of that will be on some of the, I suppose, costs that I mentioned, or potential cost savings I mentioned before. And that could be where the pot money in terms of what you can return, grants or whatever, to developers or companies. Finally, on your integration, this is a key point, that sustainable drainage needs to be integrated and considered at the earliest stage of design. The last thing we want, as I've experienced, and I'm sure it's happened many times, others as well, you come after the fact. Maybe the architect and planner, they've already got their development set out. The engineer comes along and says, oh, well, you've got to put in a swale here, you've got to do that there. And they, all of a sudden, they see they're losing, their density is going down, and they see the engineers being back. So it's very important, if you can, that's all, spread the word so that we get in at the earliest stage. Talk about sustainable drainage at the early stage from a sort of planning and catchment perspective. So that's about it. That's about all I came up with. So thanks very much for listening. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to do my best to answer them.